Hi, do you have a house you want to sell? Maybe you're looking for a new house. Maybe just want to refinance the one you're in because the climate is really not very good right now. Housing market changes every day. Sometimes it's good for the buyer, sometimes it's good for the seller. But if you're buying and selling, you need to understand both. What is the interest rates? What do you need to do? What does your credit score need to be? How much money do you need to make? Can you get in that house that you've always wanted? Is it the time? Is everything right? So getting everything in order is really important. So what I've done is I've asked a very special friend of mine who I've known, oh my gosh, for at least like 10 years. He's been in my networking group for a long time. He's helped a lot of people that I know get mortgages and refinance their house. And he explains things really, really well. And a lot of people just love him. So very fortunate that he's carved out a few minutes of his time because he's a very busy guy. To give us more information about the mortgage world and how to get into it, how to sell, how to refi, how to do all the things that you need to know. So I'm really excited to welcome my guest today. So stay tuned. You're not going to want to miss this. Hi, I'm Honey Gregory, and welcome to my channel, Perpetual Learning, where we are continuously learning. Because if you're not learning, you're dying. And, who wants to die, right? I'm so fortunate. Like I said earlier, I have the most amazing special guest today. He knows it all when it comes to anything to do with mortgages. He's my
Oh,
new
you're too
guru.
kind.
No, you're my guru. I swear to God, you're my guru. And I mean, he's a loan originator. He helps people refinance. He helps people learn about, he coaches them with the points and your score and just when's the right time to buy and all this kind of stuff that I know absolutely nothing about. So that's why we have our expert here today, my friend that I have known for what, at least 12, no, 10 years, probably about 10
Like 10
years.
years, been a long time, yeah.
I know, right? So everybody, give a good, nice, warm welcome to my friend John LaBella with Gateway Mortgage Group. Hey, John.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm so happy you were able to squeeze this in. I know that things got a little crazy this week with you having to have your kids, but I appreciate you going ahead and saying you could continue to do this for us.
Sure, absolutely.
All right. So, John, give us a little bit of background. Like, how did you get into the mortgage lending? How did you start this business? There's people watching because a lot of times on my show, I also like to teach people, like, not only about the wonderful guests that I have on there, but what if they want to become, whatever the guest does? Because a lot of people are like, how do I do that? So, I want to hear all about the mortgage industry, about you, about what you do, and how you can help people because right now the climate is just weird out there.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I started doing this about 21 years ago,
Oh.
and I was in a networking group, and there was another fellow that was in there that worked for a non-bank mortgage lender, and he always talked about doing mortgages, and it never resonated with me. I never understood, well, why would you go to that guy? Why would you just not go to your bank for a mortgage? And so, and I was in a different industry then, so I didn't really pay a whole lot of attention. And then fast forward a couple of years, 21 years ago, and I was looking for a job, and it was like a friend of a friend of a friend kind of thing. And I called a couple of different people, and I talked to one guy that was working at a place right here in Bloomington, and he just went off about how great the industry is and how much he loves working in it and how much fun it is and how passionate he is about it.
Wow.
And so I said, okay, great. Well, how do I get started? He says, well, the
Yeah.
first thing you want to do is don't work where I do. These
Oh.
guys are slime balls. So
Oh,
I'm
well.
going to tell you to call somebody else.
That's a good
So,
tip, right?
no, right? He's like, I work here, but you don't want to work here. So I called somebody else, and anyway, I went in and interviewed, and he hired me, and I stayed there for about 3 years, just kind of learning the ropes. The guy was one of the longest standing non-bank mortgage loan originators in Bloomington. He'd been doing it for like 20 or 25 years before I even walked in to see him. And
Wow.
so I kind of cut my teeth there. And after about 3 years or so, I just was feeling like, I think I can do this a little bit better on my own. And so I looked for opportunities to, instead of working underneath somebody else's umbrella and not having any share in the revenue, I figured out a way that I could do it where I could operate kind of like an owner, where I have the revenues and expenses all credited to me and operated as my own business. And I nice. Did that first with a company called Gateway, which is what you'd mentioned when we first met. I was with Gateway,
but yep.
transitioned from there.
Yeah.
And so Gallery Mortgage, and I've been under that umbrella for, oh, I don't know. I think we opened up our space just down the road about 10 years ago. And then mm-hmm. we moved into our current location about 6 years ago.
Yeah. And you have a beautiful place. And I love the fact that, now, did you call it Gallery Mortgage because you have the gallery in there, or was that just a coincidence?
No, we did it because we have the art gallery. Now, when I had first joined the other company, there was no gallery. It's just in 2009 when I looked for a place in Bloomington to actually, you know, hang my shingle and unlock the door. I moved into a place that was had been a gallery, an art gallery, for many, many years, and they had gone out of business, and so we rented the location, and so we were trying to reconcile how we were going to use the beautiful space that we were in, and then also sell mortgages out of there, and they're kind of not really related,
right,
industries, and so we thought, well, let's just kind of blend the two together. And so in the previous location, we worked inside the gallery space, which was really pretty neat, but it also had some challenges because folks would come in, patrons would come in to look at the art, maybe buy something. But if I'm on the phone talking to somebody about their credit score, their bankruptcy, you know, we had to kind of hit the pause button and say, well, you know, how about the Cubs, right? And and make small talk until the people left the art gallery. And so a few years ago, we moved to another location where we have dedicated gallery space, and then all of our offices and conference room is separate, so we can have the private conversations and there's not that overlap.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I remember when you were in the other location because I had originally gone to that art gallery, and then I went by and was like, that's where his office is now? That's interesting. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, well, actually, this is really cool because I love art. And I thought, dang, I would love to work here because I could look at art all day.
Yeah,
this is great.
So it's kind of a neat parallel for us. We support only local artists. And then when we have any sales, we don't split with the artists like a traditional gallery would. 75% goes to the artist and 25% goes to local charity. We don't share in the revenue. It's purely a give back for us.
Nice.
And then we currently support New Hope for Families. And one of the things that I feel like is important for our business is we generate all of our revenues and we pay our employees and our expenses, and all the profits come from folks that have stable housing.
Yes.
And so we wanted our charitable partner to always be an organization that helps support those that don't have stable housing. And
yeah, that's important.
We had supported Stepping Stones for many, many years. And then, you know, they had some of their challenges with losing their leases so they're not really operating like they used to. So we made the transition and we've been supporting New Hope for Families now. And it just feels like it's good synergy for us.
Well, that's great. You know, any successful business nowadays, when you look around, the more successful they are, there's always people, charities that they fund. Because, you know, to give is to receive. And the more you give, the more you receive. And
absolutely.
You know, you've always done things like that. And that's one of the things I've always admired about you. But a lot of people may be tuning in today because they're like, oh, my God, the interest rates. What am I going to do? I want to move. I don't want to be here anymore. But my gosh, the interest rates are 5 times more than what I'm currently paying. So what, you know, let's talk about that. People want to move, that there's no houses and nobody's moving, you know, because nobody can afford to move because the interest rates are 2 or 3 times more than what they're, you know, currently paying. Or if they're trying to get into a new house, they're first time buyers. My gosh, you have to make, you know, $1 million more to buy a basic home. So give us some tips and ideas what people should be doing now.
So a couple of things. The first one is to maybe zoom out and take a look at the bigger picture. Although rates right now are higher than they've been in my entire 21-year career,
they used to be higher, though. They used to be higher. I remember 12.5% or something like that back in the late 80s or something. I looked at buying a house and you couldn't. It was not affordable for anybody.
Yeah. And so, you know, they're only marginally higher than they were for most of my career. Mm-hmm. One of the things that's happened in the whole COVID, post-COVID climate is rates were ridiculously low. You know, rates began with a 2 and a 3. Mm-hmm. And people have kind of gotten that into their mindset that that's where rates should be. But that's more like an asterisk that you put up over here And it's not really, you know, it's kind of like when you look at a, you know, Major League Baseball stats and, you know, they have a stat, but they have an asterisk on it. It's because there's a special situation.
Yeah.
Same thing. It's a special situation. And really, you know, for the last 21 years, except for COVID, rates have been in the fives and the sixes and the sevens my entire career.
So it's kind of like, kind of like the pendulum thing. So 12 and a half over here, swinging around and then reaching the twos and threes. And so pretty much the balance is somewhere in the middle, right?
Exactly. And, you know, do I think that rates are going to continue to go up? I don't know. I mean,
yeah,
none of us have
gamble.
A crystal ball.
Yeah, it's a gamble.
Excuse me. You know, I read all the trade magazines and I read all the economic things, and everybody has a different opinion. So it's really, really hard to kind of wrap your hands around it. And so I'm more of the opinion of, instead of looking at the scenario and saying, well, hey, rates are really high, I'm not going to do this or I can't afford this, look at it from the point of view of, okay, well, here's where we are.
Mm-hmm.
This is what the rates are today.
Mm-hmm.
So what can you qualify for
yeah.
based on your current income and your current debts? Or what can you do to tweak your profile, either to augment income or to reduce some of your liabilities, or to maybe change what your punch list of items are, your the must-haves on your dream house?
Yeah.
You might need to tweak that a little bit because we're not in a 3% climate anymore.
You might need to think of, instead of I'm going to buy my dream house, I'm going to buy my now house.
Mm-hmm.
And then the first opportunity when the interest rates drop again, which could be 5, 10, 20 years from now, then you can reevaluate over time. Like, am I making more money? Has the interest rates changed? What can I do different? And also, you know, you might get married or you might get divorced or, you know, things change in people's lives that affect you. But paying rent is never a good thing because you're making somebody else rich.
You know, if people say rates are at, you know, 7%, 7.5%. Well, rent is 100%.
Yeah.
None of it's going
exactly.
none of it's going towards
yep,
you
none.
Or building your equity, and you don't get any of the appreciation.
Mm-hmm.
And your point is spot on that most of the time when people buy a house, they're thinking, oh, I'm gonna be here for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And then the reality is divorce happens,
mm-hmm.
job changes happen, babies happen,
yep,
kids move out, like
yep.
There's all these other forces that come together. A parent gets sick, and so they want to move closer to the parent.
Yep.
And so the reality is people don't keep their mortgages longer than about 5 or 7 years.
Right.
Now, we do have a little bit of an unusual situation now because just a massively huge percentage of folks that own real estate today have interest rates that begin with a 2 or a 3
mm-hmm.
or a 4.
Well,
and
they
they
refinance. They refinance. Yeah, they refinanced or bought when it was really low. And
right.
Now what are they going to do?
So
they're going
right
to have to
now,
downsize if they move.
Well, you have to downsize and pay cash.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you just downsize and get a new mortgage, it could actually end up costing you more because rates may be double. So right now today, the two biggest things that are fueling the market are transient type communities. And I don't say transient from a, you know, from a kind of a nefarious point of view. I say it from like Bloomington, we're a college town.
Mm-hmm.
There's professors, they come in, they're here for 5 years, they leave. Parents come in, they buy investment property for their kids. We've got a lot of pharmaceutical manufacturing that's here. They bring in engineers and managers. And so there's a lot of influx of new folks coming into town. So that's the one thing that's fueling the market is job transfers, whether it's here in Bloomington or anywhere in the nation.
Yeah.
And then the other piece is, quite frankly, divorces.
Yeah.
And so when you have a divorce scenario, you have either a house that's hitting the market or one of the spouses needs to refinance to get the other spouse off.
Yep.
And the spouse that is vacating is also wanting to purchase. So those are the things that are fueling the market right now.
Yep.
You don't have people downsizing. Even your first-time home buyers a few years ago, they're not upsizing right now. But as time rolls on, regardless of what rates do, life circumstances are going to happen.
Yeah.
People are going to get transferred. They're going to get divorced. Mom or dad are going to get sick, or a child's going to get sick, or they're going to make babies. And so the things that normally happen in the marketplace, they're a little delayed right now because there's this big noose of, hey, let's not do anything because our rate is so low. But eventually that's going to go away. And so I'm going to go right back to what I was saying before about what do you need to do to qualify? based on today's interest rates, your income, and your liabilities, or what can you do to tweak any of those items or your credit score to make things more achievable? This is a credit score driven business. And I mean, it's a seesaw.
Yeah.
The higher your score, the better your terms. And then it goes like this. If your score is worsening, your terms are worsening. Yeah. And so really, it's just a matter of right out of the gate. First, number one, know your buying power. Because getting online and looking at Zillow or Realtor.com, Redfin, anything else, you'll get a lot of excitement, but it doesn't really help you know what can you actually qualify for.
Right.
And the other piece of it that is a little confusing for folks is all of those websites will also show you an estimated payment, but they don't indicate what credit score is driving that interest rate, what the interest rate is, what's the down payment. So what's the loan amount that's driving that payment? And is there mortgage insurance included in there because the down payment wasn't big enough? And so a lot of folks, I get calls all the time. People see something on Zillow that they really like and they see what the estimated payment is and they call me and they find out they have 5% down, not 20 or 25%. So they've got a higher loan amount. Maybe their credit score isn't top tier. So they got a slightly higher interest rate. And then because they haven't put 20% down, they have mortgage insurance. And so it's really important, instead of relying on the online resources, to contact a knowledgeable and reputable loan officer and have them talk through your individual scenario and provide guidance as to what you can do now, what you might be able to do later, or what you can do in the interim to get yourself into the best possible place for the most attractive loan terms in the market at the time that you're ready to buy.
Yeah, and it's good to plan ahead of time because, you know, they come in, they see you, and things aren't as ideal as they had hoped, but you can give them guidance and tips on how to improve everything so that maybe 3 months, 6 months, or a year from now, they can actually achieve whatever it is they're hoping for, right?
Absolutely. And, you know, you'd be surprised how most people do not have that perfect credit, that 780 or better credit score. And most folks have a lower score than that, or they have some credit cards that are maxed out, or they have a prior bankruptcy or possibly a prior foreclosure, or they've had medical bills that have gone to collection, or they've had final utility bills at a prior residence that never got paid because they never got the bill and it went to collection. And so there's all of these things out there that just, they start hammering away at your score. And someone that's been doing this for a long time can take a look at your credit report and tell you where to maximize your dollars to tweak your credit score. Is it paying off an old collection, or is it paying an extra $500 on your credit card? And one can have a really big effect on your score, and one can have a very small effect on your score. And so you really want to talk to someone that has that experience to know what's going to have the biggest impact. And when it comes to qualifying for a mortgage, there's a couple of umbrella topics that are going to be looked at. It's going to be credit, employment history, income, assets, and then, of course, the property itself. And so it's anybody that's interested in the marketplace right now is going to have to make sure that every one of those five buckets, everything's exactly where it needs to be. And so, again, just like before, your point is spot on, that preparation and dealing with things ahead of time is the way to go. The first step isn't to call the realtor because you saw the house online and you're really excited about it. The first step is to contact the loan originator and say, hey, I want to buy, and get that conversation going. Because if you skip that step and you go straight to the realtor, they're going to say, are you pre-approved? Let me have you talk to somebody.
Yeah.
Or, okay, I'll show you one house, but that's it. Then you got to go get pre-approved. And it's because those five buckets, the credit, employment, income, assets, and property, there are so many variables that have to all intersect at just the right place in order for it to work. It doesn't make any sense to start with the property piece. You got to start with the borrower and the credit and the employment and the income and the assets first.
And I don't think that's common knowledge, because I know when I thought to myself, I'm tired of renting. I want my own place. I'm tired of throwing money away. What did I do? I went looking at houses.
Right. It's what we all do.
But, you know, I mean, it did inspire me to like, okay, yeah, this is really what I want to do. And this is what I want, what I don't want. I mean, it was inspirational, but I never thought, am I going to get a loan?
Right.
Will they let me buy this?
Yeah,
I was just like, I'm gonna go look at houses.
well, and the other thing that can be extra challenging is, and this is the side of it that consumers never ever see. But when you go online, I don't care whether you're at any one of the, like a Zillow or a Redfin or any bank online, when you see the interest rates posted that they say, hey, our rate is 7.5 or our rate is 7.25, what they're not really making obvious that you have to read the fine print about is that that is based on 780 or better credit score, typically 25% down, and a loan amount of X
Wow,
dollars. And
25%.
for a conventional loan. And Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac have always had what they call loan level price adjustments, which basically state that the lower your credit score, the bigger your adjustment. The smaller your down payment, the bigger your adjustment. And in the earlier part of this year, they took those loan level price adjustments and they expanded them and made them even more punitive for folks. So there's a lot of sticker shock out there. When people go online and they see, hey, rates are 7.5 right now, if you don't have that 780 and 25% down, you're not getting 7.5.
Oh my
You might
goodness.
Be getting 7.75 or 8 or 8 1/8.
Oh my gosh, that's terrible.
Right.
This
And
is
so
bad news.
So important to get started early so you can tweak that score and find out what you need to adjust so you can get the best rates. Because admittedly, rates are really kind of bad right now compared to the last 21 years.
Yeah. And I was wondering, because I have clients that are, they're veterans or they're in the military. Is there anything special that they can do to help them get into a home easier and faster?
If they have their certificate of eligibility, and there are certain requirements that have to come with that based on years of service, that would allow them to seek a VA loan, which is essentially 100% financing.
Wow.
And there's no mortgage insurance. Even though there's no down payment, they don't have to pay mortgage insurance. Most people think about, hey, if I don't have 20% down, I have to have mortgage insurance. Well, with a VA loan, you do not. The VA does charge an upfront funding fee that varies, whether it's the first time you've used it or a subsequent use. And it's also waived if the veteran has a service-connected disability. So if someone is a veteran, they have their certificate of eligibility, and they don't have a large down payment to make on the house, it's actually the single best financing option out there in the marketplace. But of course, you can only get it if you have that certificate of eligibility.
Right.
If you get to the scenario where you've got a large down payment, sometimes it doesn't make sense to use that certificate. Sometimes it makes sense to just get a traditional Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac loan because the terms will be comparable. There won't be any mortgage insurance either way, and you don't have to pay that funding fee that you have to pay on a VA loan. So there are times when you could have that certificate and doesn't make the most sense. But if you have a small down payment and you have that certificate, then it almost always makes the most sense to go that route. And the second beneficial program, instead of VA where you have to have the military service, the USDA administers a rural housing program called Guaranteed Rural Housing. And that also is a true 100% financing option with zero down payment. It does have its own restrictions, though. The first one is that you have to be in a geographically eligible area. And the idea is to encourage home ownership for moderate income folks in rural areas. Now, rural is not necessarily what you might think about as rural. It's going to be based on population. And so, for example, here in Indiana, in Bedford, just south of us in Lawrence County, you can buy a house right in Main Street in Bedford, right downtown, and that's considered rural because of the population. So you don't have to be out in cornfields. You can be in a community, but you just can't be in a community, say, as big as Bloomington. You have to be on the outskirts of Bloomington. So
are people eligible if they've had other homes, or is this a first-time homeowner thing?
Well, you can be eligible if you don't currently have suitable housing. So you can sell your home and buy another one, or you can be a first-time home buyer, but you can't have an acceptable home.
And then... so you have to sell it and then go, I don't have a place to live.
Exactly. Now, there are some exceptions if you outgrow your property or you get transferred. I mean, there are some, you know, carve-outs, but you do have to be in a geographically eligible area. And then also, since it is to encourage home ownership for moderate income folks, there is a household income limitation. So if you make too much money, you can't qualify for that program. And the amount of money that you're allowed to make varies by county, and it varies by household size.
I see.
So
wow.
there's some,
see,
I mean, so.
And this is so complicated. I mean, you're just, this is the tip of the iceberg. You're trying to be, you know, helpful here and giving us the you know, the tiny little sliver. But it's these sort of complications and if this, then that, or whatever, that people need to come see you or another loan originator, because it's just too much for the layperson who's not involved in this all day long.
It is. It is exceedingly complex. Yeah.
And always changing, probably, too.
It is always changing. And when folks look online, they can get enough information to kind of get an idea of where they might want to go. But all the little details and all the little if this, then that items are not readily available by doing Google searches. And you only can get that by talking to a reputable mortgage loan originator, whether it's at a bank or a non-bank mortgage lender.
Yeah.
But I mean, we only just scratched the surface on USDA and VA.
Yeah.
FHA has its own set of circumstances, enhancements, why it's beneficial in some areas and why it's not in others. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac conventional loans also have their advantages and their disadvantages, and there's even differences between the two of them. And it's not just the down payment and interest rate considerations. Each of those are called agencies, and each of those agencies treat student loans differently. And whether they're in a in-school deferment or an income-driven repayment plan, or whether they're fully amortizing, those are treated differently. The agencies have different waiting periods for different credit egregiences. So prior bankruptcies, prior foreclosures have different waiting periods at different agencies. Credit score, debt ratio, what your debts are as a percentage of your income can only be so much. And that amount that it can be varies from program to program. And so sometimes, although perhaps a Fannie Mae conventional loan would be the best loan for this person if they could qualify, they might have been too soon since their bankruptcy that if they want to buy today, they have to go with a different loan program, even though Fannie Mae would be better financing. And so there's so many variables that come into play.
And then you can sit down with someone and go, well, you can do this, but, or you can do that if, you know, that sort of thing, and lay them all out. So a person can say, well, do I want to go ahead and do it now? Or do I want to wait because I can get a better deal if I wait a few months? But when you're trying to do it yourself, or you're just going, you know, randomly doing it, then you're not going to really know. You're not going to know, because I don't know, you know. But
no,
I get people all the time too saying, because, you know, in a divorce, both parties' names are on the house. And one of them's like, well, I want that one to move out, and I just want to assume it because I can't refinance. I don't have the credit or whatever. And I'm like, I don't think you can assume a mortgage you already own.
Mm-hmm.
So people are very confused. I mean, and I tell people all the time, go talk to the experts, because I don't have a clue.
Well, and I see the other side of it where, you know, one of the ex-spouses is staying in the house and the other one is given 6 months to refinance. And it's been decided between, you know, the negotiation between the attorneys or themselves at their pro se and the judge. But at the end of the day, none of that matters. If the guy that's supposed to refinance in 6 months isn't qualified, he's not qualified. So then what happens? Well, that has to be extended, or they have to force the sale in the house, or, you know, there's all kinds of things so again, someone's looking at divorce, man, the best thing they can, and they own a house, the best thing they can do is talk to a loan originator right up front.
Yeah.
And you know, some of the best conversations I've had with folks, even when it's not an amicable divorce, is to get them both sitting down in the room together and me just having that conversation with each of them.
Good luck with that.
What's your score? What's your credit? What's your income? What's your score? What's your credit? What's your income? And then just saying, regardless of what you guys want to do, there are some things that you can do and some things you just can't do. And so this decision is going to be made for you.
Yes.
So let's have that conversation about what really is realistic. And then you can negotiate how to unwind after you know what's possible.
Right. And I get a lot of times the client, they're like, oh, I want to keep the house. Well, the mortgage on it is like $2,000, $3,000 a month. And I'm like, you don't even make that.
Yeah, exactly.
Keep this house, you know, and in their mind, like, they just don't understand. And so it's really good. And a lot of times once they do talk to a mortgage lender, they find out like, oh, okay, yeah, you know, okay, obviously I could not refi and take over this house. And then they get more realistic and they go out and they look at homes that they can get. And I talk to them sometimes. I run into old clients and I run into them years later and they're like, you know, I'm glad I got out of that big house. And I don't have that worry and that debt. And I've got something more manageable and that I know I can pay off and retire in or whatever it is. But yeah, it's just a lot of confusion. I get people all the time who like their expectations are much higher than their actual abilities under the circumstances. Because when you take and divide two incomes, your standard of living is going to change. I mean, it's just going to go down. And without someone like you who can really kind of explain everything, they're just going to be lost. I mean, they are.
Well, you and I have, you know, with your experience as a family law attorney, you and I have from the same perspective, we don't have the emotional obstruction that they do. And so it's easy for each one of us to sit down and just break it down, just chunk by chunk by chunk. Here's what you have to do. This is what you can do. This is what you can't do. But it's really hard when you're emotionally in the middle of that. Cause that's it's a horrible process to go through. You know?
I had this one woman. It's like, I raised my kids here. We still have this wall, a door or something where they had the measurements of all their children that they raised. And she was like, I can't leave. All their measurements are on this wall. And I'm like, I'm sorry, but you know, you're going to have to take a nice photograph of it or something, but you're not going to be able to stay in this home. It's just not.
No. And the next people are going to take the paint roller and just roll right over it.
First thing they're going to do is paint right over that. It's going to be gone. Yeah. It's sad. It's sad because,
hard.
It really is. But, you know, it's really exciting, though, to get a new place if you have a positive mindset about it and get a new place. And, you know, I wish I could get a new place, but the interest rates are nuts right now, and it's just not something I can do. But, well, we're almost out of time. This is so interesting. Oh, my gosh, we could probably talk all day. But any other tips or tricks or anything you want to tell anybody real quick?
Sure. So especially today when we're in what I would consider to still be a seller's market, the most critical thing that you can do when you're going to get pre-approved is to choose to go with a local reputable lender in the market in which you want to purchase in. And that's really important for a couple of reasons. The first one is that you know, lenders are all over the map, just like any profession. Some people are better than others. Some are really good at what they do. Some aren't very good at what they do. And when you get a letter from a reputable local lender, remember that when you turn your offer in, whoever that seller is and that seller's real estate agent is going to look at your offer, but they're going to look at your letter as well. Mm-hmm. And if you're working with an out-of-town bank or an online lender or somebody that they've never heard of, your offer is not going to be considered as strongly as an offer that's coming with a pre-approval letter from a lender that listing agent already knows is local and reputable and meets the financing contingency deadlines and meets the closing deadlines and doesn't drag things on. And so that listing agent is going to be yapping in the ear of the seller, oh, don't go with that offer. That's this lender and I've never heard of them. Or don't go with that lender. That guy doesn't know what he's doing. Oh, but this one over here, they know what they're doing. These two or three offers, these are with good lenders. You want to consider these. And so you're going to put your offer at a disadvantage if you don't go with. So if you're putting your offer at a disadvantage if you don't submit it with a pre-approval letter from a local reputable lender. And, you know, there's a lot of, just here locally in Bloomington, there's a lot of folks that do a really good job with mortgages. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, I'd like to think that I'm one of them, but I have plenty of competition that does a really good job.
Yeah.
But all of me and all of my competition that does a good job, we also know who doesn't do a good job. Yeah. And so it's really important to, you know, if you don't have a friend to recommend somebody to you, talk to your realtor. Realtors have the opportunity to work with every lender, the ones that are good, the ones that aren't so good. They know who's going to knock it out of the park in terms of, first of all, the spreadsheet items, rates and fees. But that's not the only metric. That's the metric that everybody knows to look at.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also going to be all of the intangible metrics when, you know, in terms of communication and expectation management and not hitting people up for, you know, now we need this. Well, now we need this. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, making sure that that financing contingency deadline is met so that if it's not, you can get your earnest money back and it's protected. And nobody wants to blow a closing date and have the seller threaten to, you know, pull the deal and say, no, you know, you have deadline. And so it's not just rates and fees. Everybody that's reputable is going to be within a very narrow range on rates and fees. It's going to be all the other intangible metrics that are so important. And that realtor knows who nails it on everything and who doesn't. And so trust a recommendation from a realtor because they're in the marketplace every single day.
Yeah.
If you don't have a realtor, ask your preferred lender who they would recommend. As a lender, I work with all the realtors in town.
Yeah.
And just like in any profession, some are better than others. I can give an idea or a recommendation on who I think is going to do a really good job for them. And so just getting online and going to Bankrate or going to Zillow, the wrong way to get started. Trust your realtor. Look at reviews. Go online and Google the lender that you want to work with and read their reviews. That'll give you a good insight into the heart and mind of the company and the type of job that they do.
Yeah. The reviews are pretty good. I mean, I know sometimes people just get on there when they're angry and do something and say things, and it's not always accurate. But so it's definitely one of the factors to consider when you're, you know, selecting someone. Especially, you know, you've been around a long time. You know what you're doing. 20 years. I mean, that's hard to find.
A little while. I'm getting a little gray hair when I don't shave it off.
Well, nobody can see it right now. It's just all shiny.
You can see it right here.
Oh, that's, you know what? What's that? Grecian formula or something. You can fake it.
Right. I should start combing in the color.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Why
no,
not?
This is my wisdom here. The
this
gray is,
your, is
my wisdom.
Showing your wisdom up front.
Right.
So what if someone wanted to buy a commercial building? They've got their house. They're okay. But, you know, they decide, you know what? My business, like myself, I've thought many times, like, I would love to have my own building. I'm tired of renting because I'm throwing money out the window, you know? So what if someone wanted to buy some commercial real estate?
So commercial lending and residential lending are completely different animals. And so your folks that specialize in residential lending will have commercial opportunities, but it's not going to be what they're used to doing. It's not going to be their bread and butter. And the same thing, if you were to go to a local bank and you want to get a commercial loan, you're going to talk to a completely different department and people than if you wanted to get a residential loan. And so typically, and I'm going to paint with a broad brush, but typically if someone has the requisite credit and down payment and ratios, they're probably going to get better terms at a local bank for commercial financing than they are at a commercial mortgage broker. That's not always the case, but I also know there aren't very many commercial mortgage brokers. So, it's, you know, there's a lot more opportunity to just shop among the area banks. The opposite, I shouldn't say the opposite, but that scenario is not true with residential lending, where it's not that you would always get a better deal at a non-bank mortgage lender than you would at a bank, but there's a lot more competition and there's a lot more options. And so everybody has to be real competitive. So like, that's what I said before.
Right.
If you go with somebody reputable, the rates and fees are in a pretty narrow band. It's going to be different things than the rates and fees that are going to drive where you're going to go for your residential mortgage. But for your commercial stuff, that's really going to be more of a loan terms and metrics driven monkey. And I think you'll do better going to a local bank.
Okay. That makes sense because they probably do a whole lot more of them than someone like a, you know, like your type of, what do you call it? Broker, mortgage company, whatever.
Yeah. Mortgage banker. Yep.
Yeah. So I was trying to think what else would people might be interested in if, you know, if they're buying, but, I know that some people would maybe like some young person who's trying to figure out what I want to do with my life. They might like you one day just go, you know what, this sounds interesting. How do I get into that field? So what would someone do if they wanted to become a mortgage lender like yourself?
So there's a couple of different ways to start. But what I would recommend is to begin by working either as a mortgage loan processor or as a loan assistant to an already established mortgage lender. Because if you don't work in a bank and you work in a non-bank mortgage lender, it's going to be commission only. So if you don't already know what you're doing, and have relationships with folks, you're going to start out and make zero for a while. But if you can fold in and work for an already established mortgage loan originator and be there as either their processor or as their loan assistant, you're going to get all of that experience while being paid a salary.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you still decide you like it,
mm-hmm.
then you can work towards making that transition where you come off a salary and start going over to commission and start working on relationships and people you know. But it's very, very hard to start right out of the gate, never having been in the business, and just start.
Yeah.
Even at a bank where you'll get a salary instead of being paid on commission, but you know, the salary you're paid relative to the work you're doing, most people aren't going to end up staying at a traditional bank for very long. But if you want to start, it's a great place to start because, again, you won't be doing the loans themselves, but you'll be assisting the originator with gathering W-2s and paycheck stubs and bank statements and tax returns and communicating to clients and learning the guidelines and all of those intricacies that we talked about earlier. It's impossible to read the guidelines and memorize and know all of them. It's more an experiential kind of knowledge that you just gain it over time as things come up. And so I would highly recommend going to someone that already is established and figuring out if they need assistance. There's also a pre-licensure education that one has to do, and then they have to take an exam, and there's continuing education, but that's only for when you've already got your feet wet and gotten some of that relevant experience.
So you start out as an assistant, or a processor, and then meanwhile you're also working on the learning and the exam, getting certification at the same time.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Well, and that's, you know, that's easier than going to college for 4 years and spending, you know, $200,000 or something crazy, because you're working, you're getting hands-on experience. You can, a lot of those classes now are online. Ever since COVID, a lot of things have gone to online, or you got a hybrid or something like that. So you can, some of them are at your own pace. So you could do that, you know, in your spare time, if you have any.
You can do a lot of self-learning. And you know, if you are one that can understand technical very, very well and simultaneously be good at establishing relationships, and those are two different sides of the brain.
Yeah.
If you're one of those people that can manage both, excuse me, I'm sorry, I've been battling a cold for a couple of weeks.
Oh, that's okay. I appreciate it.
If you're one of those people that can ride both sides of the fence,
mm-hmm.
this is easily a six-figure job.
Mm-hmm.
Not out of the gate, but after 5 years, easily a six-figure job that you can sustain and maintain.
Yeah. And you know, you said relationships, that's key. You're networking and making friends and getting your name out there. That's key no matter what the business is or what you're doing, period.
Exactly.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, what else are you going to tell us about other than your kids are almost out of the house and they're almost grown?
Well, I want to put out there one more little nugget that's I run into all the time that people sometimes don't realize when it comes to their credit. You know, just about everybody has credit cards. Now, some people carry balance and some people pay their credit cards off in full each month. And so I'm speaking to the people that pay their credit cards off in full each month. That when I talk to them, they'll say, oh, I don't have any credit card debt. And maybe they've got a Capital One card with a $5,000 limit and they charge $3,000 a month on there and they pay it off every month. So they're constantly charging and paying and charging and paying. And so in their mind, they don't have any debt because they pay it off every month.
Right.
If they've got a $3,000 balance, the credit bureaus only get their information from the creditors once a month when the statement generates. So every month when they get that statement that says, hey, your balance is $3,000, pay it off in full by X date to avoid finance charges. That $3,000 as a percentage of, say, their $5,000 limit, well, now they're 60% utilized. They're going to have a credit score hit, even though they think, hey, I'm paying this off in full every month. You know, I should have perfect credit. No. So if you're the kind of person that pays your credit card off in full every month, even though you're given the float and the new charges, you don't have to pay until the next month's statement. If you're trying to qualify for a mortgage, talk to your loan originator about timing when you're going to pay off that card and pay it, you know, as of the due date, pay off more than just the previous balance, but all of the charges that have ensued since then. So when that statement comes out, that balance is really low as a percentage of available credit, and it'll bump the score up significantly. So that's a little trick that you can use to qualify, especially with the new Fannie Mae loan level price adjustments. You have to have that 780. Really, really important that people realize that just paying your credit card bill off in full every month is only one piece of the puzzle, but you can still be getting dinged on your score even though you're doing that every month.
That's interesting. That's something people should know just in general, because you need to know.
Yeah,
that's fantastic. Fascinating. I never thought about that. I don't pay mine off every month, though.
Most people
I'm
don't.
Good. Mine just keeps rolling over. Oh my gosh, you're the best. I just love having you around. I miss you at being at NTI.
NTI.
Yeah,
I almost came this morning. I just couldn't make it happen. Too many other things going on.
That's okay.
Today.
That's how life is. All right. So, any last words?
Again, I'm just going to reiterate.
Okay.
Get qualified first before you get excited about property.
Yep.
Follow your realtor's recommendation. Use a reputable local lender and have the conversations early about your credit, your employment, your income, and your assets so that you can put yourself in the best possible position instead of getting mentally attached to a house and then having it not work out.
Yep, that's a great summary and fantastic tips. And thank you, John.
Yeah, thank
I appreciate you so much. You know, right? Don't you just want to do this like every day? This is so much fun.
Good.
I love
Good
it.
Good to see you in 2D. I always see you in 3D. Huh?
I know.
I see you in 2D, right?
Well, I can't give you a hug like I usually do, but it's all good.
There you go.
Oh, there you go. I love it. Well, I appreciate you so much. You're amazing. You're awesome. You've always done a great job. Everybody I know says you're amazing also, and they love working with you. So I'm so grateful. So thank you so much for being here today and taking your time out from your daddy responsibilities and joining us on Perpetual Learning. So if you're not learning,
this was a lot of fun.
If you're not learning, you're dying. All right. Thanks, John.
All right,
have a
care.
great
we'll
one.
See you next Thursday at NTI.
All right. See you there.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye.